us on level playing field, right? We are all saved by his blood, we're saved by his grace, and he has kind of leveled the playing field, hasn't he? So as we sing this song, let the joy of God just come through your heart, through your words, as maybe you're able to sing, or if you're out there watching us online, maybe you can sing in your house and just have a great time worshiping with us this morning.
I was buried beneath my shame. He could carry that kind.
Can I get guitar and monitor? I went in direct now, okay? Went direct. I'm gonna bring up the monitor. Let's sing this together. Here we go. I need a rescue.
I need a rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was
get the guitar up and a monitor for me, please. Thank you. continue our worship.
Eternal God, unchanging, mysterious, and unknown. Your boundless love, unfailing grace and mercy show. Bright seraphim in ceaseless flight around your glorious throne. They raise their voice in day and night in praise to you alone. Alleluia, glory be to our great God. Alleluia, glory be to our great God. Thank you.
this battle with the strength of my own hand. You're the mountain mover, and only you can. I will build my life on sinking sand. You're my hope forever, the rock where I stand. I won't win this battle with the strength of my own hands. You're the mountain mover, and only you can. I won't build my life on sinking sand. You're my hope forever, the rock where I stand. The rock where I stand. I love the ground in sinking sand. I love the ground in sinking sand.
Sacrifice that you meant to give us, Lord, that before the foundations of the world you knew that our sin would have to be paid for, and you decided to lay all things down, all the treasure, all the majesty, and put it all down for a cross. Father, just thank you so much that you somehow, some way, wanted to make that relationship with us, and you did it through your own blood. And Father, we are just so thankful. We're grateful who you are. We're confident, Father, that you will see it through, that you will see, no matter what station of life we're in, whether we're rich or poor, wherever we are, that you are strong enough and faithful enough to bring us salvation and to give us a place to be with you in eternity. Thank you so much for that, Lord. Amen.
Hello, everyone. Let's give it up for our worship team this morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Olivia Ciotta. I'm the Discipleship and Extend Ministries Coordinator here at Southridge. And this morning, I just want to welcome you to our service, both online and here on the lawn, and tell you a little bit about some things going on around the church this week and in upcoming weeks. So first up, we have Women's Gathering. Women's Gathering is an event that we started beginning last fall, and it's been a really impactful opportunity for a lot of our ladies. Last spring in April, we offered it virtually via Zoom, and we're doing it again this fall. So for all you ladies out there, mark your calendars for October 24th, 10 a.m. Log on Zoom, and we will be having a virtual gathering. We're going to be hearing from Joan Fiore, who is one of our Extend partners from Italy. She'll be sharing a brief testimony with us. And our very own Kim Moore will also be sharing a devotion with us this morning. And the theme of that event is going to be geared towards trusting God in the hard times. And so I'd encourage all of you ladies to sign up. Sign-ups open today on our website. You can go to southridgecc.org/womensgathering for more information and to sign up. And if you've never used Zoom before, there are also some Zoom instructions for those of you that haven't hopped on Zoom yet. Secondly, we want to highlight an opportunity coming up at the end of the month on October 31st. We're calling it Harvest Gathering. And this is an in-person opportunity that's going to be here on our campus. And it's for families and individuals of all ages to come out and just kind of celebrate and conclude our time being outdoors this fall and summer. And this will be just a time for fellowship, for families with kids, for individuals. We'll be offering some fall-flavored treats that will be COVID-safe. Everything's going to be individually wrapped, so you can feel free to come out and enjoy those. Our worship team is going to be leading us in a time of worship. They have some fun surprises planned, and then the evening is going to conclude with some fireworks. So you want to make sure that you come out. That's October 31st from 5 to 7. So wear your favorite fall sweater or your fall flannel, or if you want to, your Halloween costume. Everybody is welcome. We'd love to see you come out. Again, that's October 31st. You can find out more about that on our website, southridgecc.org, under harvest gathering. And lastly, we highlighted this opportunity last week, but we are looking for some new members for our tech team. Our tech team has been awesome throughout this whole season of getting us up online and helping us sound good every morning here on the lawn. So they're looking for some new members. So ages 14 and up can be a part of that team. They're looking for audio engineers, camera, lyric operators, tech aides. You don't have to know anything ahead of time. You're going to be completely trained by Laren and his team, and you'll get to be a part of making what happens here on Sunday morning happen, and you'll get to be a part of a really great team. So if you're interested in that, make sure you reach out to Laren. And as always, you can get details about this and everything else that's going on here at Southridge on our website. If you just go to the homepage, click Current Opportunities, you'll see all the information there. So I am going to turn it over to Nathan.
Hey, thanks, Liv. And good morning, everybody. How are you? Here we are in, like, pre-hurricane, right? And thankfully, the hurricane has held off for us. I guess lots of rain is expected tomorrow, tonight and tomorrow. But so thankful that we are still able to gather here. We're going to also be giving you an update on regathering plans. Obviously, as it does cool off outdoors, we'll need to change plans and move indoors. So we'll be getting you some communication about that. And I saw the other guy go down the road just a few minutes ago, and I thought, I bet more is coming. So there is. Thank you so much for your generous and faithful giving to Southridge. We greatly appreciate that, especially in this particular time. I cannot simply express just heartfelt appreciation for your continued faithfulness in giving. There's a verse in 2 Corinthians that simply says this: each one must give as he has decided in his heart. No reluctancy or compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Our text this morning in James is exactly a little bit about financial issues. And that verse just really strikes me. God loves it when we give cheerfully. And as we say here at Southridge many times, we don't want folks who give out of compulsion, out of obligation, but out of a cheerful heart for what God has blessed and given to you. So thank you so much for that. This morning I'm going to have Walt Sykes come out. Walt's a part of our congregation, and certainly, as you are aware, our country has experienced just a lot of challenges racially in the last number of months. In addition to all of that challenge, there's the challenge of politics and just a lot of times the anger that comes out of that. And so I asked Walt to simply come and pray this morning for our country, for us as a congregation, that we would be the kind of reconciling people that God asks us to be. In 2 Corinthians, Paul says that we don't regard anyone from a worldly frame of view. And what he means by that is often our world categorizes people. He says we don't regard people primarily from the position of whether they're liberal or conservative, Republican or Democrat, whatever race or ethnicity they are. We don't regard people that way. And folks, if there's any body of people that's to be a reconciling influence in this world, it's followers of Jesus. Paul goes on in 2 Corinthians 5, all this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. He has committed us to us the message of reconciliation. So friends, the Church of Jesus Christ cannot outsource reconciliation. That is not primarily a political issue. It's a God issue. That's a church issue. That's a followers of Christ issue. And so we're really passionate at Southridge about, as much as we're able to be, the reconciling influence of God in our world. Walt's going to read the prayer that he wrote. So often when we pray, we kind of pray spontaneously. But there is also just a depth and an intentionality that comes from reading a prayer. That discipline is healthy as well. It's certainly healthy to speak to God spontaneously, but it's also healthy, and it gives a sense of deliberateness and intentionality when we read our prayers as well. And read prayers can be just as heartfelt as those that might be offered spontaneously. And so as Walt reads that prayer, make this your prayer. Pray along with him. Pray it with a sense of deliberateness, intentionality, and depth that sometimes a written prayer offers. So grateful for my brother Walt, his wife Karen, his family are part of our congregation here at Southridge. And brother, thank you so much for your willingness to come and lead us in prayer this morning.
Thank you. Can we pray together, please? Father, in the name of Jesus, we come united as believers in the message of the cross. As we gather together, united in faith, as members of one body, help us to remember that we are part of one another. We pray together for our country and for our leaders, that you would grant them wisdom, patience, civility, and with the purpose to act in the best interest of all the people and not just some. We pray that you would strengthen your church to stand boldly against all acts of violence, injustice, immorality, and abuse of authority. Guide us that our hearts, that our minds, that our eyes will be open so that we may become more aware and sensitive to seeing evil in these things, in whatever form it may take or hide. Father, do not give the evil one the opportunity to allow these things or political ideology to separate us as believers. Give your church the courage to not sit in silence when we know that these actions are not aligned with the loving behavior that you've taught. Grant us the wisdom to navigate these difficult conversations that's dividing our country, and the grace to acknowledge and to heal wounds so that our words and our actions will be a light that guides others to your throne. In Christ's name we give thanks and ask it all. Amen.
Amen. Can we all just say a hearty amen to the words that Walt led us in prayer? Amen. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Yeah, when I hear a prayer, I just love it, friends, that prayer goes up to the God of heaven. Our world so desperately needs exactly the truth that prayer asks God to act on. Well, here at Southridge, if you've been around, you know that we're passionate about caring often for those who may not necessarily have the same circumstances that we have in our lives. The passage that we're going to look at in James reminds us of that this morning. Over the years, Southridge has participated in purchasing an orphanage in Zimbabwe. It's one of the things we're passionate about. We support Ramabai Mukti Mission, which cares for often homeless females and women in the country of India. We have a child development center that we work with in El Salvador, and many of you sponsor children in El Salvador. We're invested in places that care for refugees, for places like Assyria. And so we're very passionate about refugees and those who are fleeing places of violence. Believe it or not, the last service we had here in our auditorium as normal was back on March 8th. And then March 7th and 8th, we had Peter Holmes here. And Peter talked to us about the plight of the persecuted church, persecuted followers of Christ all over the world. And we at Southridge are particularly passionate about caring for brothers and sisters in Christ who face difficult circumstances in parts of the world where followers of Christ are harshly treated. right here in our own location. Many of you have participated with Family Promise in the homeless ministry right here in Hunterdon County, providing care and fellowship and food for those who are homeless. Right across the street is the Hunterdon Developmental Center. And many over the years, we've had many interactions with them. They serve the severely handicapped and disabled in our state. The Jersey City Free Farm Market, many of you have participated in that as we offer produce to those in Jersey City who would otherwise not have access to that. The Ed and Mahan Correctional Facility that's behind the developmental center is a place that is for the incarcerated women of New Jersey. Unfortunately, during this time, we've had to take a significant step back in our involvement there, but that's another one of our passions. We have a care fund for our congregation and community. And so caring for those who may be in difficult circumstances is something that's near and dear to our hearts. But friends, this is something we need to constantly refresh, constantly grow deeper in, constantly have our heart cultivated after God's heart. And in James chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, or verses this morning, James talks about how to think through and how to respond to people going through different kinds of circumstances. In James chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, here's what he says. And notice right away the differences in the circumstances that people are experiencing. He says, believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride. Believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride in their high position. But the rich should take pride in their humiliation. Right up front in this little letter of James that we're going through here on Sunday morning, James talks about those in humble circumstances, and he talks about those who are rich. First thing, friends, we just want to dive into for a few minutes is this. Notice the differences that James says that people find themselves in our world. James is probably intending to take us back to earlier on when he says in James chapter 1, verses 2 and 3, he says, consider pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. Right out of the chute, in the first number of verses in James, James acknowledges that all of us bring to the table different stories, different journeys, different backgrounds, different circumstances, different places where we've been, different places from which we've come. He acknowledges that many of us face many kinds of trials. He opens that door wide. Friends, here in this gathering, there are as many stories in this gathering as there are people. Those of you who are online, those of you watching in our auditorium, every single one of you has a story, has a journey, and every one of our stories, every one of our journeys is different than the person who might be seated next to us. James says, we have many trials of many kinds. So you're not fully aware of the trial, the burden, the circumstances of the person seated next to you, or the person in your home or household, or the person that you work with. Your story is different. James acknowledges that there's some who are in humble circumstances. Probably by that he's referring, by contrast, to those who may not have resources at their disposal. Because next he talks about the wealthy. And their circumstances are entirely different. Some commentators differ as to whether James is talking about believers who are wealthy or unbelievers. But whatever the case is, James is saying we have differences among us. Every one of our stories is unique. And friends, I just want to remind you that wherever you are right now, your story is unique. And here's what often happens. We only see the exterior of other people's lives. But we see the interior of our lives. We only see the outside of others, but we see the internal thoughts of our lives. We compare our unseen to the seen in others. We often compare what we see externally, what we see on the outside of other people's lives. We compare that to our internal feelings, our internal story, the internal burdens that we have. Friends, I just want to remind you, your story is unique. Your circumstances are unique. You may look at others and say, they have an easier story. They have an easier time. But friends, your story is unique. The battles that you deal with in your soul, you don't know the battles that other people may deal with. And friends, we need to recognize that too when we talk and interact with others. The stories of other people are unique as well. I love this quote by C.S. Lewis. He says this, "There are no ordinary people. You have never talked to a mere mortal. Nations, cultures, arts, civilizations, these are mortal. And their life to ours is the life of a gnat. But it is immortals whom we joke with, work with, marry, snub, and exploit. Immortals, horrors, or everlasting splendors." I love that. C.S. Lewis says, you have never met an ordinary person. You have never talked to a mere mortal. Friends, I just want us to remind us of that as we begin this journey in James this morning. He acknowledges that some believers are in humble circumstances. Others may be blessed with some kinds of wealth. And he reminds us every single one of us has our own story. Every one of us right now might be carrying some kind of burden, some kind of weight that's on our shoulders. And here's what we need to remember. When we interact with one another, when we interact with those who we know, those who we don't know, because every person has their story, we need to act and interact from the standpoint of gentleness. Philippians chapter 4, verse 5 says this, "Let your gentleness be evident to all." Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 says, "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience." Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 23, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." Friends, often gentleness is something that we often don't think about because we live in a harsh world. We live in a world that's tooth and claw. We live in a world where there's harsh reality, and sometimes gentleness may not seem to get the point across. But friends, simply based on the fact that we don't know what somebody else's story is, what somebody else's circumstances may be, gentleness should be something that characterizes our lives. Gentleness in conversation, gentleness in interaction, gentleness in social media. How much would the world change, friends, if we simply interacted with the spirit of gentleness? Remember when Stephanie Gray came here a couple years ago? Stephanie is just an amazing woman who travels literally all over the world and speaks about the particular value of the unborn and champions the treatment of the unborn as true human beings. And she speaks all over the world, and we were really blessed to have her here at Southridge a couple years ago. And I remember her saying that, you know, man, this is kind of like, I still remember her saying this. I remember her saying, you know, sometimes I'm in this debate forum, and, you know, people ask me, what about a child that's conceived by rape? What about that? And I still remember her response to that. She said, when somebody is asking that question, they're not asking, they're not trying to figure out if the baby is human. Most often, they're trying to figure out if you're human. And she told a number of stories about people who pushed back and said, you know, what about rape? And almost angrily so confronted her And she talked about approaching them with gentleness and finding out that part of their story was a rape. And her spirit of anger and hostility melted into weeping because she responded with gentleness. She understood that their story first needed to be heard. That they needed to know that somebody understood their story. Friends, listen. James talks right out of the chute. Believers in humble circumstances, those who are rich. Again, it's probably mostly in the financial context, but every single person has their story. When you interact with somebody on politics, when you interact with somebody over some of the most lightning rod moral issues of our day, friends, as much as it's important for us to communicate truth, we also need to be people who are filled with grace. Remember, every one of us has our story. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. May that characterize your life. May that characterize this congregation. I challenge you as you go throughout this week, as you interact with folks, as you're on social media, let your gentleness be evident to all, precisely because you don't know the story of the other person. You don't know the weight that they're carrying. You don't know the burden that's on their shoulders. There's differences, and that's the first thing that's evident in James chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. The second thing is that there's also a discrepancy. Not only are there differences, there's a discrepancy happening. Listen to what James says. Believers in humble circumstances, we already talked about varying circumstances. Believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride in their high position. But the rich should take pride in their humiliation. Friends, that's entirely backwards from what we would anticipate. There's a discrepancy between what we would naturally assume and what James tells us to do. There's a discrepancy between how we would naturally respond and how we would naturally see things and how James says things actually are. He says believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride in their high position. That's a discrepancy. We would think, man, if you're in humble circumstances, you shouldn't take pride in your high position before God. There's a discrepancy between your circumstances and your status, between your circumstances and your state. What's happening to you and who you are two different things. There's discrepancy between what's seen in your life and what's really true about you. There's a discrepancy between what seems to be true and who you actually are. There's a discrepancy between how things look and how things actually are. Throughout Scripture, we're reminded that whatever your circumstances, if you're in humble circumstances, your high position is that you're a child of God. If you're in difficult situations, your high position is that you are loved by the eternal and creator God. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 says this, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called the children of God." Friends, whatever circumstance you're in, no matter how low you feel it is, you can take pride in your high position because God's love is greatly lavished on you. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 and 7. "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ." Listen to this. "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us." Friends, however humble you feel your circumstances may be, the riches of God's grace are toward you. James says, take pride in that. Friends, that's not merely psychobabble. That's not merely church talk. Often when we hear something like that, we say, okay, that's nice Bible stuff. Now I've got to get on to solving my real life problems. That's nice God speak. That's nice Bible speak. That's nice church speak. Now I've got to actually figure out the real problems that I have in life. James says, take a time out, friends. You've got to deal with this. Whatever circumstances you're in, James says, take pride in your high position. You're a recipient of the lavish love of God. You're a recipient of the riches of God's grace. You have every spiritual blessing in Christ. We often think this, because I have less, I am less. Because I have little, I am little. Because I have minimal assets, I'm a minimal person. Because my possessions are negligible, I'm a negligible person. Because what I own is minimally important, I am minimally important. James says that's not the way it is. There's a discrepancy. Even though you may be in a position of humility, of humble circumstances, you can boast in your high position in Christ that you're a recipient of the lavish love of God. And then he kind of flips it around. He says there's also a discrepancy the other way as well. He says, but the rich should take pride in their humiliation. Wow, it's kind of counterintuitive, isn't it? The rich should take pride in their humiliation, since they will pass away like a wild flower. There were particular wild flowers in James' day that would kind of bloom in the morning and flourish in the morning mist and dew. But by the heat of the midday sun, they would begin to fade, and they would begin to become lifeless. He says this, for the sun rises with scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossoms fall and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, the rich will fade even while they go about their business. James says there's a discrepancy in those who have humble circumstances. Because their humble circumstances, they should actually take pride in their high position with God. They're still lavished by his love. They're recipients of the richness of his grace, but then he kind of flips the table. He says those who are wealthy should actually take pride that their wealth does not bring them ultimate stability in their lives. Their wealth, their riches, does not bring them ultimate protection, but that wealth is fleeting as well. Sam Alberry says this, one of the great deceits of wealth is the impression that it gives solidity. It feels permanent and dependable, as if it can be counted on to bear the weight of our lives. We tend to equate wealth with security. Once we have enough financial resources squirreled away, we know that we're covered. Friends, it's so easy to be there. Many of us are blessed to live right here in this larger region of New Jersey. And it's a region where there is often a higher level of affluence and a higher level of wealth. And it's so easy for us to kind of think of ourselves, whatever our possessions may be, as being more, maybe more substantive, more stable, more secure. But friends, James says that whatever we have is not who we are. I've done a lot of funerals, friends, over the course of the years that I've been in ministry. I used to have a t-shirt that said, you know, he who dies with the most toys still dies. In every funeral that I've ever done, no person has ever been able to arrange to take with them the resources or assets that they may have had. We often associate prosperity of bank account with prosperity of our souls, and we know that's not true. We associate prosperity of popularity with prosperity of our personal being, and we know that's not true. We associate prosperity of our looks with prosperity of our lives. We know that's not true. We associate prosperity of vocation and career with prosperity of purpose and calling. We know that's not true. We associate prosperity of financial investment with prosperity of life investment, and we know that's not true. James says, prosperity of bank account, prosperity of vocation and career, prosperity of financial investment, that does not equal prosperity of life investment. It does not equal prosperity of your being. It does not equal prosperity of your soul. It does not equal prosperity of your life. Later on, he says in James chapter 4, he says, now listen, you who say today or tomorrow we will go to this city or that, spend a year there and carry on business and make money. Why, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. James says, there's a discrepancy, and friends, every one of us needs to acknowledge that. Some of you may be in humble circumstances this morning. What I want to exhort you to do is take pride in your high position. Take pride in the fact that you are the recipient of the lavish riches of God's love. You are the recipient of the grace that's in Christ Jesus. If you're in a place of affluence, if you're in a place of wealth, I want to remind you, handle that with the deepest of humility, because wealth does not provide stability for you. It's not the secure foundation on which to build your life. And so God's call is for you to be humble, to acknowledge that your life is much deeper than the assets you may possess. We looked at the differences, the discrepancy. Lastly, just a couple comments on opportunity. Opportunity. You know, for each of those categories, James says there's an opportunity for growth. There's an opportunity to cultivate depth in your life. For those who are in humble circumstances, there's an opportunity for you to cultivate the maturity of dependence on the grace of God. You know, we talked a little bit about this a few weeks ago. We said hard times enable us. They give us the opportunity to see our life from the lens of a larger picture. That rather than simply frame our lives, rather than simply look at our lives from the visible, from the temporal, hard and difficult times enable us to sort of pan back, to stand back, and to cultivate a more disciplined focus on that which is truly secure, that which is truly eternal. You know, kind of the way this works is many of you have had children. All of us were children at some point. You've probably seen children operate in this way. You know, when a baby is first born, the only thing that baby can possibly do whenever it has any kind of needs, the only thing that baby can possibly do is simply cry. That's the only thing they can do. Once that baby begins to grow up, maybe it's a toddler, the toddler can begin to actually articulate the needs that it has. You know, if that child is hungry, can ask for food. But take a cookie from a toddler, that toddler doesn't have the maturity to sort of see life from the larger perspective. And that whole child's life is right in that moment of time when circumstances are going poorly and he can't have the cookie. The whole child's life is swallowed up into that one moment. And child often throws a temper tantrum. So it's an evidence of lack of maturity. A little more mature than an infant. An infant will simply cry whenever it's wet or it's hungry. That's all that infant can do. It's that level of maturity. A toddler can at least speak, but if you take something from that toddler, it can't see the broader perspective that life is broader than simply whether or not that child can have the cookie. And so we know that the maturing process is the process of broadening our perspective of what life is about. Toddler grows up and broadens a perspective that life is not just about the moment where that child can't have a cookie. And so humble circumstances are an opportunity, friends, for maturity, for us to pan back, and maybe the idea of the riches of God's grace, the lavishness of God's love, maybe that's often just words that we hear. But hard circumstances, humble circumstances, offer to us an opportunity to become more mature in our faith, to span back to the bigger perspective and see that God is at work in our lives, not just in the moment, but for all eternity. That whatever hard time that we're going through, it's momentary because God has the eternal picture in mind. In James chapter 1, verse 4, he said, "Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." So maybe your humble circumstances, friends, maybe your humble circumstances are an opportunity for maturity. Maybe it's an opportunity for maturity, an opportunity for to internalize what you previously haven't really internalized, to actually make God's grace cultivated into your life. We move from information to internalization. We move from information to God's truth becoming that which your identity is based on. You might just want to think about these questions. Are you more shaped by your sense of inadequacy or by the wonder of being created by God? Are you more shaped by your insufficiency than you are by the wonder of the generosity of God's grace to you? Maybe your humble circumstances are an opportunity to generate maturity in your life. For you to become more focused on the beauty and wonder of being created by God and saved by His grace than simply being overwhelmed by the circumstances that you may find yourself in. That's one of the opportunities. The second one is not only opportunity for maturity, but an opportunity for generosity. Maybe some of us are on the higher end of the spectrum in terms of finances that God has entrusted to us. And friends, the message that we get is so different in our world than what God tells us to accept. Here's some of the message that our world gives us, that our surrounding culture gives us when it comes to kind of affluence or wealth. The world says, take what you can get. World savvy says, power up. This world savvy, when it comes to possession, says, be self-assertive. It says, gain the upper hand. It says, keep the other person in their place. It says, prove that you're the superior deal maker. It says, stay on top of the mountain. The world savvy says, establish the pecking order. The world savvy says, climb to the top of the food chain. That's messages that we're fed, friends, every single day. If you have affluence, you have it because you earned it. Stay on top of the food chain. Establish the pecking order. Make sure those around you know exactly where they stand, that they're not quite on your level. Make sure everybody knows that you're the superior deal maker in the room. Make sure you get the upper hand. Be self-assertive. Power up. That's the messages that we receive. The message of Scripture is that we should have gospel generosity. That generosity should flow from our hearts as the generosity of God has flowed toward us through the person of Christ Jesus. Gospel generosity, friends, honestly, it can sound naive. Gospel generosity can sound simple-minded. Gospel generosity can sound non-assertive. But gospel generosity calculates with eternity. Gospel generosity rejects personal ownership and embraces personal stewardship. Gospel generosity rejects higher status and embraces deeper servanthood. Gospel generosity rejects hoarding and embraces giving. Gospel generosity rejects clinging and embraces offering. Gospel generosity rejects claiming and embraces sacrificing. So if you're in the humble circumstances end of the spectrum, you have an opportunity for maturity, to take pride in your high position in Christ. If God's blessed you with affluence, it's an opportunity for grace-based generosity that embraces sacrificing, offering, giving, servanthood, stewardship, and the big picture of eternity. As I said in the beginning, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 9:7, each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Friends, you know the circumstances that God has given you. May his Holy Spirit whisper into your heart how he wants you to respond in humility and maturity, generosity and servanthood toward others. You know, our team is going to come out, and in a second we're going to sing the song, Be Thou My Vision. And as they do, just going to want to circle back to where we began. Friends, every one of us has a different story. May we be gentle toward one another. May we be kind-hearted toward others. You know, I've mentioned here before periodically, but one of the things I'm involved in our community is being on the board of trustees at the Huntington Developmental Center. It's an opportunity that I've had for a few years. And one of the reasons, friends, why I do that is because sometimes I almost feel like I need it for my own sanity. The Developmental Center has probably 500-600 residents, 700. And they have some of the most severely, both physically and mentally disabled in our whole state. It was a number of months ago, I think it was at the end of last year, I honestly forget when it was. Had one of the staff over there contact me, and I get to interact periodically with some of the residents and in different kind of circumstances over the years. Some of them have been here on our campus participating in our services in years past and part of our SR Kids programs, and it's just I just love those interactions. And so when he said who it was, I knew who it was, didn't remember her name, but just a woman who's got just really, really severe muscular dystrophy, literally spends her whole life in a wheelchair. She has one of those things in her wheelchair, one of those machines that she can kind of press buttons and get letters and words and sentences out. And she has someone who works with her to even do that because she's not adept enough at pressing the right buttons. So she's just really, really severely disabled. And she asked if I could visit her. She, this was communicated to me by one of the other staff there. She said, you know, my mom passed away. My sister passed away, and this is the information I got from the staff member there. And she said, I'm really just struggling with sadness in the recent loss of my sister. And then the note that was given to me by this gentleman who, again, I was on staff and contacted me. He said, hey, if you can just remind him that is me when he comes. He said, remind him of a couple things. Number one, I might cry. It's a time of sadness in my life, and I might cry. And she said, number two, I'll explain this before I get to it. Often when you kind of interact with a disabled person, particularly physically disabled, people can often associate physical disability with mental disability, and that's not often the case. And so sometimes it's easy when you interact with somebody who's physically disabled to kind of think that they are mentally disabled as well and can't fully interact as an adult. And she said, remind him that I'm 73 years old and I want to interact with him as an adult, not as a child. And friends, that has just stuck with me. people with different stories, with different kinds of circumstances. And here's a 73-year-old woman that's literally never spent a day in her life out of a wheelchair, not a day in her life, who literally needs even help communicating with machines that she's given. She says, my heart is aching because I've lost my sister. And please, just interact with me as an adult. Hear my story as an adult, not just as a little kid. I don't know what story you have. Some of us are in humble circumstances. Some of us may be blessed with affluence. May our vision be on God. May He be our vision. So that if you're in humble circumstances, you know that you're being loved by a God who lavishly loves. If you're in affluent circumstances, that you know that doesn't bring substance to your life, that you also desperately need the grace of God. And friends, may we be gentle to all, because all of us bring our circumstances. All of us bring our stories. All of us bring our journeys. Imagine how life would change if we just were gentle. So maybe I could ask if you stand where you are, and if you want to sing, you can, or if you just want to listen. May this be the prayer of your heart. As they sing the song, may your prayer be, not just the song's words, may your prayer be, God, be my vision. Be my vision. May my vision be broader and bigger than just the here, now, and visible. May my vision be enlarged. So offer this to God, friends, as the prayer of your soul. Offer it to Him. One second. You know, one thing I love about our team, friends, they're not just performers. They're real people. And I don't know, this story that, like I told, made me emotional and just kind of overwhelmed with that a bit. And Gabrielle's supposed to sing the song and just kind of wasn't in the space to do that. So I don't know if you're, can we just maybe just give you a hand and just encourage and support you? And we're all in that space. Let's just thank Gabrielle. Yeah. We're not performers, friends. It's a real deal. We just kind of like offer to God what we can. So if you can do it, great. If not, we all understand too. So yeah, whatever you can do. And yeah, just if you can't, that's cool. If you want to second, that's cool too.
Save now, from my pain.
God, may you be our vision. Whether we're in humble circumstances, whether we're rich, as James says, God, may you be our vision. May we be lifted up by the lavishness of your love. May we be humbled that our affluence does not make our life solid. But at the end of the day, we'll simply come face to face with you without any of our assets. God, may we be gentle one toward another. May our gentleness be evident to all, knowing that we each carry a different story. May we be a congregation who's gentle to each other and gentle to our world. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. It's his name we pray, and everyone said, amen. Hey, thanks so much for joining us this morning. If you just give our team appreciation again. How about the sax this morning? Hey, the New Here tent is over here, offering boxes. There's one in the Welcome Center as well. New Here or offering. Thank you for joining us online or on campus. God bless. Have a great week.